decides what to do.
You are now watching Not Channel Zero, The Revolution Televised. We're coming to you from a straight up Afrocentric and grassroots tip. Politics, culture, re-education. That's what we're about.
The most disrespected person in America is the black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the black woman. The most neglected person in America is the black woman.
Issues that black women have uniquely is being a part of oppressed people and also addressing an oppression.
This thing about, you know, we can struggle at this level, but we can't free the women. You know, we can free the race, but somehow we can't free the women became such a clear dichotomy that, you know, that folks just couldn't get down with that anymore.
Not only have we been oppressed in a racist society, but the whole system is, and the ideology is wrong because it's based in a male point of view. And we're talking about ego. We're talking about the male ego, which that in itself is, is a heavy subject. So, you know, it's a lot of pressure. You know, it's a lot for us to be fighting against.
There's too many young women having children, and they're not bringing their children up right. So we're stuck with a lot of black children who don't have proper education, and they're just kind of going wild on the streets and everything. And everybody's looking and saying, this is our future generation, and we're not taking care of them. And to an extent, that's true, and we have to look to ourselves for it and stop expecting the government to pay for everything, you know, organize our own groups and stuff like that.
My father works for the state of Pennsylvania Welfare Department, right? And it's like, he's telling me that he hears so often that women have the attitude, I mean, and it's like a woman-to-woman thing because he mostly doesn't hear it with men telling their daughters or something like that, or men telling their sons, you know, I can't wait till you grow up till you get your own check. I mean, that's what he's telling me. You know, honey, I can't wait to take you off my thing so I can get my money, so I can use my money to go somewhere. When you turn 18, you can go in the office, fill out these forms for yourself and get your own check. I mean, if you're sustaining that type of system, you're instilling that type of mentality in your child. When she gets up, when she grows up to be 18, she sees what all her friends are doing. You're saying, look, when I turn 18, I can get me a check. You know, I can get my food stamps, I can get my WIC. You know, everything's taken care of. Maybe I could find a boyfriend who will help me out. You know, maybe I can like dress nice and stuff like that. You know, and it's like, I think that, like she said, my most important thing that kept me out of that whole situation was my parents telling me that, look, you got to do what you have to do. You have a directive.
That came from basically being a welfare recipient to now working, but I mean, it wasn't all that easy. What I basically had to do was go back to school, okay, to finish getting my degree. I mean, you have to want it, and that goes for anything in life. I didn't want to be your typical quote unquote welfare recipient for the rest of my life. I remember standing on the face-to-face line, and this little old lady in front of me said, I've been on for 20 years, and I kind of like associated that with what I was going through. I said, no, that will never be me. So I basically went back to school, and I had kids. Went back to school, finished my education, got my BA, and then from there I went and got me a job and got off welfare. And I have been off for what, over like 10 years. 10 years, and now I have a good job. I'm still working, and I'm still going to school. That's why I'm here at NYU. I'm still going to school, trying to get my master's for advancement, because I mean, once you say, this is where I want to be in life, you've given up so much, okay? Once you've gotten that comfortable that you don't want to achieve anything, you might as well just lay down and basically die.
One thing that we can thank white feminists for is the documentation of the history prior to Wade. That, you know, what women lived through. They also documented the fact that the vast majority of women who died and were slaughtered and murdered by illegal abortion were Black and Latino and Native American women. So, you know, then the argument is thoroughly inconsistent for nationalist, Black nationalist men to say that abortion is the equivalent to genocide. No, genocide is when you don't protect us, when we have no protection, and we die. If I die, then, you know, that's the end of it.
Because of the state of the economy, particularly the state economy, the city economy, poor people in general will suffer, and Black people, Black women and children in particular, are a part of that population that will suffer. And there's just a serious lack of affordable housing. And of anything we don't know about, it's a symptom of the capitalist system. And I'm not this raging communist or saying that, look, you know, we have to go the way of Marx. I'm just saying the capitalist system is not designed or tailored to the issues of human need in terms of providing for people first. If it were, we would not see what we see every day on the streets.
Battering is a huge problem. Women are more hurt from battering than they are from car accidents or any other kind of violence that happens, the physical violence from being battered. And most of it takes place right in a personal context. You know, somebody, a husband, a mate, you know, that kind of thing is what, where you get that from, and you're taught that you're weak, and somehow have to accept that. I also need to add, because not to foster any kind of violence, is that economics keep a lot of women in this position. You know, not leaving the battering situation means going into a shelter situation.
We cannot guarantee to our families or to our children adequate medical care or equal medical care, you know, like separate but equal schools. We don't have separate but equal medical care, you know. You cannot guarantee, we don't know, none of us knows really, those of us who are in Black communities, the situation of the medical care is just extremely chaotic.
Within Black culture, certainly males think their oppression is greater. That to be oppressed as a male is greater because women should be subservient anyway. So sexism had already been so rooted in the world culture at that point, and certainly in the evolution of American culture, that, you know, so, you know, it's bad for you, but it's not as bad. We're still operating out of that. I mean, I did some interviews around International Women's Day, and like Black women are still saying, well, it's like, am I Black or am I a woman? What kind of dichotomy is that to be asked to have? You should not have to think about that. You know, it's like we're split. Which half is going to be which? You know, what does that mean? So I think those are conversations that women are more and more, Black women are more and more feeling safe to have.
We take on that subject. A lot of people say, oh, well, we don't want to look at that because you're being divisive and all of that.
When people say divisive, like, you know, well, that's divisive. I don't want to talk about that. I don't even want to deal with that because that's divisive.
You know, it's a total front. You know, it's about, I do not want to deal with my contradictions is what it's about. I do not want to be called on them, and I do not want to be asked to explain what they are. You know, just take it for granted that I'm correct and that my politics is correct and that you need to be on board with me, following behind me, and just, you know, trust me. You know, trust me and I will lead you out of bondage. You know, well, ain't nobody led me out of nothing yet. You know, and my position is that not even another sister can lead me out. You know, the answer is what I do for myself. You know, and that as I step, that I'm pulling other people with me, men and women.
A guy just standing around on the corner, I look and I say, just another nigga, because you ain't got nothing better to do with your time than stand on the corner.
Okay, but you would be in proper form to say that. But how about if a white person said, oh, he looks like a nigger? Then all of a sudden, you'd be all over him, right?
Growing up in the projects, you grow up knowing that those guys who stand there with the beat boxes on the floor, the ones with the hats pulled down low, a pair of shades, or stand there like this, those are niggas. Okay, that is the way I grew up in the projects, hearing it.
that those are niggas, don't associate with them kind, because they're nothing but trouble.
And for the sisters who say they mad because I suggested that the brothers slap us in the mouth if we talk disrespectful, then don't talk disrespectful and that won't happen. No kind of demonstration of anything, just don't do that.
Don't leave me, Jimmy.
Oh, woman, get out of my face.
The problem between brothers and sisters is not stemming solely from or mainly from the black woman being putting down the black man. That's a misconception that has been allowed to flourish because it hides the real issue, and the real issue is the capitalist system is a kind of system that is designed to destroy the basic fabrics of family structure. For example, you have Shahrazad Ali, who writes a supposed guide to for black men in relationship to black women. And it's a long put down of not only black men but also black women, and this is allowed to be distributed because it's a sensational cartooning of real complex problems that deal with how do we struggle to develop better social relationships within a dying system and within the need of a black liberation movement. It's a very complex thing that is oversimplified and grossly distorted by a book like Ali's book.
There needs to be some clarity about revolution.
Niggas are playing with revolution and losing. Niggas are scared of revolution.
People really seem to think and believe that when Rosa Parks decided that she was not getting up on that bus in Montgomery, that everything happened from there. Decades of work had gone, I mean, centuries of work had gone on, but particularly in this movement, decades of work had gone on. Ella Baker was organizing in the South in the 40s, in the late 30s and 40s, long before Rosa Parks ever had a political thought. You know, lots of women were organizing in the labor movement, you know, teachers. It was teachers in Birmingham that really organized that movement. Rosa Parks didn't organize anything. She just took a particular action, but it was black women teachers who actually organized the Montgomery bus boycott. You know, but that gets written down in a few places, but you have to do some serious research to find that, you know, to find the roles that these folks play. But
in the 60s, what the cultural nationalists tried to propose was that black women should look to Africa or back to African history for inspiration on how to interpret their role as women. And it seems to me that what is happening now is that you're seeing the same kind of proposal going on in terms of how black women can make a valid contribution to the community and to change and to revolution. It didn't work in the 60s, and I don't think it will work now because
this is a man's world
of the kinds of problems that women had then, were beginning to have then, and are really having now.
Organizations that were nationalist in orientation, that were urban in place, in geographical location, that pushed a male chauvinist, the sisters got to walk behind me kind of thing. And there was serious clashing occurring within the edges of the Southern civil rights movement come 1967, 68, that is when the Panther Party was coming into being, and also when the nationalist movement on a large scale was on the rise.
But you hear this glorification of the Panther Party and other, you know, black liberation struggles and organizations, but you never hear any discussion about the rampant sexism that was the rule of the day. That was, you know, that was just as much an issue and a central point in those organizations as was the political line, whatever it was. You know, that women were not to have a voice, were not to be decision making, were to be, you know, in only the most subsidiary roles. That was the rule. And, you know, I hear sisters talk about it all the time who were in the movement, but I hear them talk about it, you know, in rooms together or, you know, at the end of certain conferences when we're together, but you never hear them talk about it in any forum like that. And actually, some of the stuff that Asada wrote in her autobiography, Asada Shakur, also talked about the New York Panther Party and the Revolutionary Action Movement and what they went through in terms of women there.
When I first went to a Panther office and they had the health programs, and there was a room with like stacks and stacks of like birth control pills piled up in corners. And I remember it was like all these, the thing was, you know, how genocidal that was. And then all, it was all the things about the women having the babies for the revolution. And then all the women after the revolution happened or didn't happen, or however you want to look at that. And who had all the babies still? And so, but they didn't make the decisions about the birth control being in the corner. So what, you know, women have to decide in terms of their own best interests. And it's just, again, it becomes a real issue. I don't believe in having children for de-revolution or for any purpose. We have, you know, you have to decide about having children and think about that in that way.
So, it, you know, it's always real interesting to see what folks say from that perspective. Now, when we read the books and we read the documentation, you know, we read about the great Huey Newton and the great Eldridge Cleaver and the great H. Rapp Brown and the great Bob Moses, you know, and the great Martin Luther King and the great this one and the great that one, and you are hard pressed to find the name of a woman. And usually the only woman they throw up at you is Rosa Parks. You know, and but then they never tell you about all the other women who organized that movement. Or they never tell you about Fannie Lou Hamer, or they never tell you about Ella Baker or any of the other sisters who were part of the Panther Party. It was not an organization of just men. You know, but the perception, I mean, you know, folks talk about now that black women are duplicitous with the media in terms of the oppressive images of black men. But the reality is, when you look at how the Panther Party was portrayed, it was black men in black leather jackets with black tams on. It was only men. And that's right, and black guns. It was only men. But even they, in their public posturing around the image that they wanted to project about the Panther Party, they never said, this is an organization of men and women. You never saw a picture of men and women locked arm together. You only saw men, you know, and you were really hard-pressed to find sisters. I think the one picture that I've seen that shows the sisters is a demonstration that they had at the state capitol in California, where Huey is in jail and is on trial, and their sisters standing out front, you know, in the traditional posture, and the brothers are having a press conference. You know, so the sisters are standing there, you know, like this, while the brothers are having a press conference putting out the line.
Men are projected, brothers are projected over sisters because, as I stated earlier, we live in a basically sexist society. And that means that women are not supposed to have leading roles. Women are not supposed to be intellectual leaders or organizers and so forth. And so it's a very, very fantastic contradiction, especially in the black community, when we see over the history of our struggle, women in fact in leadership roles, women in fact putting their life on the lines when there are many brothers around who would be thinking about doing opposite things. Contemporary, local and nationally, and African-American women are in leadership roles in the community. They are in leadership roles in the community organizing, in the tenants organizing, in the organizing around electoral politics, in organizing within labor. And we can just see that all over the place. There are many, many sisters who are quote unquote nameless, that is not known by the major media or the minor black media, because they're not interested in knowing them. They look and seek certain types of black men. And so many sisters get swept aside.
Just set my sister free. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. My sister's not my enemy. Cause we'll be strong together to make them all say damn.
The response that people, sisters particularly, have had in relationship to the Winnie Mandela trial, and how in New York City sisters have mobilized. In spite of brothers or not in spite of brothers, they mobilize, and they are mobilizing. They're coming together, and they are playing a leadership role in making sure that our people know the racist realities of South Africa and the blatant kangaroo court that existed with Winnie Mandela.
Has had to battle all the way to fight against the oppression of her as a human being, to fight against the dominance culturally in a traditional society where the black woman's position is in fact at home. And at the same time, she has had to emerge as the pillar in that society where she is deprived of the head of the family for very many reasons as a result of the country's laws.
We have got to understand, especially as women, that Winnie Mandela embodies the pain that we feel.
Yeah.
Winnie Mandela embodies the concentration of our efforts to keep our children and our families together.
Yeah.
That's what Winnie Mandela is all about. Winnie Mandela symbolizes our hope. She's a woman that has audacity.
Yeah.
Think about the audacity that this woman had coming out after being sentenced 6 years in prison. What did she say? Keep the pressure on. The struggle continues.
Yeah.
Struggle against apartheid and the struggle of the black woman as a woman first in society and as an oppressed woman by the racist regime. We are prisoners of our own culture.
Winnie Mandela is clear on the need for maintaining revolutionary militancy and, if need be, back into armed struggle. I mean, she's clear about that in terms of getting her liberation.
Young black men relate to black women, young or old, and where do they get their information from about, you know, their relationships with black women? They get it from television. They get it from BET and MTV.
Poison. Have these Belvin DeVoe guys talking about women are poison and this heavy misogyny that's going on, and we have to look at that and ask, why is that going on?
Black men are participating in the further debasement and degradation of black people by the way these images are projected.
Girls are beating from London, Canada, and the West End. Girls are beating. We're looking at the woman say so energy, be a battle alone,
and
she alone.
And there's like no outcry against this going on. And I find that to be very strange, that the media is either covering up the fact that we are totally against this kind of coverage, or that that African women are so complacent or feel helpless to the point where they're not saying anything about this. I think it's horrible. And I think that the view that a lot of the teenagers are coming up with is that, you know, African women are sexual objects and they're to be used and discarded. They have no history, and the only great people in African history were men.
Now, I at least want to see what's on Soul Train if I'm home on Saturdays, and I really cannot take that show anymore. It's like it's a bunch of whores,
mm-hmm.
You know, and I hate to talk about my sisters that way, but that's what I see. You know, when I drive down 42nd Street and I see people standing out there in their underwear, it's clear to me that their role is prostitute. When I see them on Soul Train, it's also clear to me that their role is as prostitute. I just cannot understand for the life of me what these sisters are thinking. You know, and I can't imagine that Don Cornelius is paying such big buck that they absolutely have to get out there and do that to themselves.
The jiggling baby.
Go ahead, baby.
The jiggling baby.
Go ahead, baby.
The jiggling baby.
Go ahead, baby. Go ahead, baby.
It's something that needs to be looked at because it contributes to the low self-esteem of African women.
For me, empowerment is being able to define one's own reality.
My being a lesbian does not negate my connection to African-American men or women as a community. And I don't think my sexuality is counterproductive to our progress. It just isn't.
We should be focusing on ourselves as far as building our own power base. I have seen every other group except for us build a base of power. We as African women need to do that.
I feel that we need to voice our thoughts, our feelings, our history, and we can do that better than anyone else, and we shouldn't wait for others to do it.
If the question is, what should Black women be doing to prepare themselves for the 21st century? I know it's going to sound ridiculous, but I think we should all be going to graduate school.
As far as the 21st century is concerned, we should be focusing on our children. First of all, as far as giving them all the information historically that's available, making sure that that information is available to them as far as their education is concerned.
All I'm asking you to do is be consistent. Just the same thing you're out there struggling about how Black men are treated, then you have to be able to say and ask for the same things about Black women. And you cannot be about liberation on one hand and oppression on the other. That's totally inconsistent. It means that you're never going to reach your goal because you're always going to be at war. You know, but that kind of dialogue, that's the stuff we need to be talking about.